I am the mighty Caleb Valhalla, and this is SWN. Skull! Skull! Skull!
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined. We're back. We've got back on interviews. There's been a couple of weeks of a quiz and a road trip, and we're back with a pit stop episode for the tour. Joined by one of the tallest wrestlers in the country, or at least in Scotland right now. Thankfully, he's sitting down, so I'm taller than him on the video screen, which is nice. I'm joined by Power Pros. Hunter Samson, welcome to the show. How's it going?
It's going good, man. It's going good. Wrestled Pro2 yesterday, through in Trun, which is good. Good experience there. That's where I grew up, so it was good to get back to the seaside there.
All right. Although unsuccessful, according to my sources. Yeah.
First out in a gauntlet and first out eliminated. What can you do?
Just have to look at the positives. At least you're still healthy at the end of it.
Exactly.
So you've done one other interview that's on our audio feed. Will be the interview with Soul for the Soul Sessions. I will try not to encroach on what you spoke about with him, but we always start with the same kind of question when we get guests on for the first time, which is the bog standard, the cliche. How did you get into wrestling? So what was your first memory of watching pro wrestling?
Of watching it. Was Royal Rumble 95. So that's the one that Shawn Michaels won. He kind of Iron Man'd it. Came in at the start, went through 30 other guys, and it was him and Bulldog at the end. And there was a whole axe handle spot, skinned the cat, back out and won it. And I was just like, what is this? Like, that was my first, I thought it was real back then. You know, I was like, this guy's amazing. I mean, Shawn Michaels was instantly hooked. And I think it was the next year he'd done the exact same thing. I think he won it 2 years in a row. Mm-hmm. And just from then, I was absolutely hooked.
We've already went into big news here. Wrestling's not real. Well, that's
really
200 episodes. I'm just finding out now.
So
1995.
Don't do this to me.
I'm joking. 1995. Then it was one of those things that it was always like, Shawn Michaels did the Iron Man. He did first to last, and it was all like, oh my god. And then when I finally saw Royal Rumble 95, I looked at the runtime that was left in the VHS. I was like, this is 33 minutes.
Not that bad. He's actually just maybe performed a normal match in nowadays. You know?
I think he's done less.
I remember watching it being like, exactly. He's done actual Ironman matches that have been more. I remember watching it at the time and thinking it was absolutely ages, but you watch it by now and you're just like, that's not really that bad. You know, you can go longer in a Rumble.
Absolutely. But Royal Rumble's always a good one to start with because Royal Rumbles are the best ones. It's the only time of year. I've cancelled my network subscription at the moment because you know, I'm not using it. But I'm still going to pick it back up again in time for the Royal Rumble.
In Rumble season, there you go.
You have to watch it. It's the best match. It's the best night of the year. I mean, WrestleMania is great, but it's like 10 hours long. And, you know, we're both in Scotland, so it starts at like 12. Midnight.
Listen, 10 hours long for both nights sometimes.
Absolutely. So, Royal Rumble, two Royal Rumbles in one night nowadays. Can't complain. A couple matches in the middle just so you can go on a pizza or whatever. So 95, Shawn Michaels was your initial favorite then. I did note that Triple H also creeped in as one of your favorites as well. So a bit of a DX being your dream team then at that point, or was it just they came at different times?
I think my two favorite factions of all time are DX and Evolution. So, like, Triple H is a firm favorite there. But yeah, it started off being Shawn Michaels, and then it kind of evolved, and the attitude era advanced. And I think it was, you know, you dip in and you dip out, you know, as a wee guy, you're kind of watching it on and off. And then I started watching it properly again, and I would say tail end of 99. There you go. Okay. Bless you.
I thought I muted it in time.
Tail end of 99, so I think Triple H had just started to, you know, it was about to be the McMahon-Helmsley era and stuff like that. So immediately from then, just this arsehole of a heel. And I just absolutely loved it. So Triple H from then was my favourite. And he was he was champion at the time as well, so I was a little bit biased. So
that was the beautiful like the big globe, the big eagle belt, and not the winged eagle.
That's my favourite belt.
Absolutely same here. As it is. I mean, I love the European belt, it's behind me, but it's the big eagle one is just that's the one you always it's the one that Austin had, the one Rock had, Mankind and of course Triple H, Mr. McMahon, of course.
It's all your childhood favourites, and recently when they done the other title, the NMC another title, and I thought it was actually going to be the original Eagle belt that they were going to bring back, but lo and behold, it wasn't. So
I know. I mean,
it's
Triple H. You knew it was going to be some sort of form of the big gold. You just didn't know how. It's one of those weird belts. It's one of those weird belts, though. The big gold, well, the new one. Anyway, it looks tiny.
Mm-hmm.
But then when like Seth Rollins wears it, it looks like okay, that's about the size of the big gold, and then he puts it down again. You go, that looks like a tiny belt. I don't know what sort of weird witchcraft with that belt.
The old WCW belt was class. It just absolutely took up most guys' torso when they wore it, right up to their chest, and you just thought that is the belt to have. So it's probably the Eagle belt and the WCW belt. They're two firm favorites. Two belts that Triple H has the hell. So there you go.
There you go. So what was it about just Triple H just being the cool bastard kind of thing? Is that the thing you liked about him?
I think I've always gravitated to heels. Even now, I just like a good heel. Even kind of developed that into my own work. I think I'm a natural heel as well. I mean, by the looks of me, it's kind of hard to cheer me or hard to get sympathy for a guy my size or that looks like me. But yeah, I've always gravitated towards heels. Heels have always been my favourites, like Triple H. Even further on, guys like when Randy Orton was doing the initial Viper stuff with John Cena, but even further back, like Rick Rude, he was one that was I thought he was class, underrated as well for his heel work, like even on the mic, just slating every crowd that he came in front of. So yeah, heels. I've always gravitated towards heels because I think deep down I'm a natural heel, but I don't know what that says about me.
It just looks more fun to do as well. I mean, yeah, you could just go out and just point at folk and just call them ugly, and they just either boo you or they laugh and going, yeah, look at me, I'm ugly.
So, and actually, say what you want and get away with it, and that's a bit of me.
No, I mean, if you want people to cheer you, you're gonna have to do dancing. I think that's the only way. If for exactly. The size of you, for being 6 foot, was it 6'7"? And
6'7", yeah, that's a shit height.
And. Yeah, it's gonna have to be dancing. That's all. That's all you can do. To
Luminous gear, multicolored. I'm gonna have to have tassels in the boots, headband, and I'm gonna have to come out dancing or something. So, like you say, it's gonna take a lot for people to get sympathy from me.
It's made you sound yourself like evolution of Retro Randy Valentine. There
you go. Love Randy. Randy, love him. Worked with him in the FCW Rumble last week. Didn't go so well for him. There's a video somewhere of me absolutely pasting Randy, but no hard feelings. I still love him.
So we'll get a little bit into your wrestling journey then. So from what my research here is, you kind of started with GPWA, is that right? So what made you decide at that point, right, I'm going to have to try this wrestling stuff? Is it just because everyone asking how the weather was up there and you were thinking, I'm going to have to take advantage of this at some point and actually pursue something I want to do?
Well, that was it. It was a combination of that. People saying, you know, when they're meeting me and stuff, you know, you should be a wrestler. You know, there's one or two things that you should be doing, either a wrestler or a basketball player. And I'm absolutely god-awful at basketball. So it was only that option. And I think I just still loved it, even growing up. I mean, at that point, I was maybe, 27 or something. And I thought, you know what, it's now or never. Mm-hmm. It's got to kind of be now. I've got to kind of push the boat out, see what's out there, and just try it. You know, you don't know unless you try. Because I could have got in the ring and I could have froze up and I could have been god-awful. You never know. But at that time there was no like reputable places to train or like anywhere that I knew of from where I was, like, and obviously because I'd attended ICW shows and stuff like that, GPWA was closely connected with that, so I knew a couple of guys that were going there anyway for like the beginner induction class, so I just went along, knew one or two guys already, dipped the toes, and then the rest was history.
So obviously you moved on to Power Pro as it is now, but go back then to attending ICW. Was it just a case of you saw wrestling was on and you wanted to get on, or what introduced you to ICW?
who ICW in particular was, if you remember the Fight Club documentaries, that were on 2012, 13 kind of time. I remember watching them, and there was just a buzz about it. Just that time, there was a big boom in wrestling, and it was just starting to come back and be like the place to go and see. So after that, I kind of attended. I think I attended my first ICW show. I think it was one of the Edinburgh shows. Remember they'd done the Fringe shows.
Oh, right, okay, yeah, with like Colt Cabana and that.
Yeah, that was it. So it was in Grado, was teaming with Colt Cabana and stuff like that. I think it was back in Studio. It was either Studio 24 or the place that was next to the old Sportsters Bar. I can't remember the name, but it was one of the. It was one of the Fringe shows. I just went along and watched it, and I was in. Drew McIntyre was in the card and stuff like that. And I was just like, this is actually class. Mm-hmm. Like, this is top quality for like a Scottish wrestling scene. From then, started, I think tail end of that year was the SECC show, the first one, the Fear and Loathing. And that was like Rhino on it and stuff like that. Mick Foley was the guest commissioner. So yeah, from there, I would just attend as much shows as I could. And that's how I found out about GPWA and training and stuff. Because going to these shows, being the size I am, everyone was always asking me, you know, you should be a wrestler, or are you a wrestler?
Mm-hmm.
I always thought, you know what, it's always been in the back of my mind, so why not?
No, you see the light die in their eyes a little bit when you go, no. And they go,
aye, no. And then they're just like, why not? Is that you? Like, that is a sin that you're not. And I'm just like, I don't know.
I mean, for a bit, were you at the back? Of the hall most of the time, because I can't imagine being too pleased to be stood behind you. Or were you a barrier guy? Were you up the barrier?
Never the barrier. No. Even at concerts, at gigs, never the barrier. I'm too. I like heels, but in real life, I'm maybe too nice for my own good sometimes, and I don't want to obstruct the view of other people, so I'll just go to the back. And I can see. I'm fine. I can see anything. I'm literally head and shoulders above most people. So.
We're spending a lot of time speaking about your height. We've got other things we will speak about. Don't worry. When you said you're too nice there, I was expecting you like being at the front and just going, if they shout at me, then I might just go, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Just start throwing them about.
So you said introduced to ICW. Sounds like you've been to other shows before then. So what introduced you to Scottish wrestling in general? Was it just a local show, WPL or something, and you end up going there?
I never actually went there. The first Scottish shows I went to was ICW.
Oh, right.
Yeah, because that was my first proper introduction to it. I mean, I knew there were shows going on at stuff, Brothers Halls and all that, but I just never went. And I think before then, there was like a lot of tribute shows that would be like fake Undertaker, fake Kane, and that just never interested me. Like, I kind of wanted like real stuff and real characters and organic content to watch, really. So I think ICW was the first one that really hooked me. So yeah, I think that was the start of it.
I think tribute shows have a lot to answer for, because it has drove away people like yourself, like you're saying, to go to try and go into Scottish wrestling shows, because they go, I saw a tribute show back in 2001 in Elgin, and it put off my parents to ever going back for a long time. They were just like, I'm going to take you to that show.
Who was the main guys on that?
I only remember a fake Mankind.
Fake Mankind.
And I think, because according to his very, very in-depth Wikipedia, Kid Crazy was on that show.
There you go.
Which, you know, I said about that there. So move on. Okay, so ICW then, GPWA, and so you knew a couple guys. Was it other trainees that you were with, or was it just you knew who was training you, Jester, Lionheart, whoever was there?
There was a couple of guys that I knew of going to be part of the beginner course as well, but I obviously knew of the trainers from watching ICW and things like that. That you're saying, Jack Jester, Wolfgang, Lionheart, BT Gunn, they were the main trainers at the time. I know it's kind of chopped and changed in the last few years, certainly in the years that I've not been there. I mean, I was only there a year and a half, maybe 2 years at a push. But at that time, those were the four main trainers that I had. And obviously I knew about them because I'd been watching them at shows. So, I mean, and I seen how good they were, and I seen the level of product they were putting out. So I was like, you know, if I can get trained by these guys, then that's just in itself, you know.
Were you put into like a, not in like a different class, but were you trained any differently? Because of course, smaller guys will be able to do more quicker things, more athletic things, perhaps. Whereas, of course, you'd have to adjust to the ring as well to take less steps. I don't know, I've never wrestled. But was there any adjustment to your training, or were you just thrown in like everyone else and then evolved from there?
No. I think the training caters for everyone, all sizes. I think the mentality was, you know, you can and should be able to do most things. There was no discrimination of size or weight or how tall or small you were. I mean, there was two rings as well in the asylum. So there was the smaller Fight Club ring, and there was the kind of the bigger ring for pay-per-views and bigger shows like Shugs and Fear and Loathing and stuff. So there was actually two rings to adapt to. So the smaller ring, you'd also have to adjust your footwork because I'm a big guy, big steps. And then the bigger ring you're working is like, again, adjusting the amount of time you're hitting the ropes for and stuff like that. But yeah, no, there was no discrimination. Like, you're doing the same bumps, you're doing the same rolls, you're trying to do headsprings, all that. I mean, I was never good at headsprings. Still am. Absolutely rotten. So, but I'm never going to bust out a headspring on a show. I'm very well aware of that.
So there was another guy, wasn't there, at the GPWA that was, we will move on to other things. I'm fascinated. Oh, yeah. Because I'm only 5'10", so I'm just I'm the national average, in many ways. So there's another guy, Flex Hunter, I think was around about that time. GPWA did you come across him? Were you paired with him quite often, or again was it just a case of
it was ships in the night? I think he had left like maybe a month or two before I joined, or I was in the beginner program still working my way up, as he was kind of on the tail end of him training. But I know he was doing asylum shows and stuff like that. I think he was part of the Black Label and ICW and stuff like that. So I knew of him, and I half expected him to see him there. But when I got there, it was all like, oh yeah, he's left. I don't know if he could be coming back. And he just ended up not coming back. But I was aware that he was a legit 6'7" big guy as well. But would it be good to train with him? Because, you know, you need the big guys to train with as well as the smaller guys. And, you know, because nothing I love more than training with a bigger guy and just beating the absolute shit out of each other.
That's it, because if the way it works at the moment, you would be doing a lot of the work, but you don't get the fun, as if you want to call it fun, of getting thrown around. So
exactly,
a big guy to throw you a little bit just to remind you. So when you say Shawn Michaels, Triple H is two wrestlers that you enjoyed watching, and later on others. Do you try to pattern your style against anyone in particular? Was anyone you watched back and just go, right, okay, I could pick that from him, like a Razor Ramon or something like that? Someone that you could pick a little bit of skills for or ideas from for your moves?
Razor Ramon's actually one I was going to mention, because I remember seeing something he had. I don't know if you remember the Breaking Ground documentary for NXT, which is on the network. I remember a scene where Razor Ramon, Scott Hall, came to the PC. And I think he was talking to someone like Baron Corbin, and he was just talking about footwork, and he was like, you know, you're a big guy. He's like, why are you taking small steps? You should be almost like trying to touch the other side of the ring when you're stepping, make yourself look big. So I've always took that advice, big steps when doing anything, as opposed to little ones. Scott Hall as well, for working punches. Like, him and The Rock, I think, had the best working punches in wrestling. They look sore, look convincing. And it was the same kind of style. It was all kind of like wrench it back, open hand slap kind of style. And in terms of just like move sets and having inspiration for big guys, like obviously the obvious one's Undertaker. I don't think you can find a more consistent or better big guy in the wrestling industry that's kept the level of work that he has. I don't think I'll be doing over the top rope suicides anytime soon, landing on my head like he does. But you never know. I might bust out. Who knows? Maybe feel for it one day.
So, I mean, there's been a litany of guys that you can draw to. I mean, Razor was kind of the first one I thought of, because he's almost deceptively big. It's like you don't realize how big he is, because he spent most of his career next to Kevin Nash, who is bigger.
Massive.
So you've got that. You got your Sid Vicious. You got all these guys that are able to do things you don't believe guys of that broadness and size could do, and they're able to do. Like, say, Undertaker could do the suicide dives and all that kind of stuff, and do that. I'm still getting used to the term suicida, because I've watched wrestling for long enough. It's suicide dive for me. But I know that's probably not the most PC term to call it now. So.
Well, yeah, exactly. But there's another one you mentioned there, Sid. I've only recently started to go back and watch a lot of Sid's old stuff. I was working with like Diesel or like Shawn Michaels or something. Like, Sid was absolutely phenomenal, like, for the stuff he'd done, like, just his size and presence. I think Sid's a massive inspiration as well, just for like being like a dominant, bigger guy. Had a great look and stuff like that. Anytime you hear someone talking about Sid, apart from like, you're always the William Regal funny stories you get, they said he was just a brilliant worker. He was always money. Then it wasn't until I went back and I watched a lot of Sid's stuff on the network, and I'm just like, this guy is absolutely class. I don't know why. I don't think they ever put the title on him.
Did, I don't think he was, they did. It was. He beat Shawn Michaels, I think it was. So, and then I think he dropped back to Shawn.
It was a quick turnaround. I remember that. And or was he in the? Has he been? He's not been in the Hall of Fame though, has he?
No, I think he was maybe supposed to before the pandemic. I can't remember. I'm going to check.
Because that's always been a strange one to me, that Sid's not in the Hall of Fame.
I think the older I'm getting now is really, right, he was set to join in 2022. So that was right about the pandemic. That was the pandemic stuff. So maybe he decided to.
Who knows what happened? I mean, it's Sid after all. It could be anything.
Okay, I think he probably went to, wasn't there always the joke that he would miss stuff because he'd go to softball games? Yeah, so he probably decided to go to that.
Okay, the Nash talks about all the time.
I haven't heard, like, for the wrestler podcasts, which is terrible of me to say, I don't listen to an awful lot of them, because sometimes it's fun, but sometimes it just gets really, really sad. And I'm like, no, I'd rather not hear about how in pain you are, because...
Or how much broken down you are, because as a wrestler, if you're hearing that in the future, you're kind of looking into a mirror of your future self. You're just like, oh God, there goes the knees. That's the hips gone. Stay by your shoulder.
Like Mick Foley talking about all his injuries. I'm like, no. Oh. I mean, I'm going to feel really guilty about watching one of my favorite matches, which is him versus Edge at WrestleMania, him versus Triple H at Royal Rumble 2000. Going,
that's my favorite match. I don't know if you heard me say that on the Soul Sessions podcast. But my favorite match of all time is that street fight with Triple H and Cactus Jack at the Rumble.
It's amazing. And it's one of those. I spoke to the boy from Bleeding Gums, Andrew Crammond, and I was telling him that deathmatch wrestling is not anything I enjoy. Yet, probably two of my top 10 matches of all time is that Royal Rumble.
Hardcore matches.
Yeah, hardcore matches or TLC matches. But
yeah,
I still wouldn't say I was a fan of deathmatch wrestling. I'm actually just
that's different level though. I mean, there's a street fight, there's no DQ, and then there's a death match. There's exploding light tubes, there's barbed wire tables, there's flaming tables. But then, you know, it's a different beast altogether.
I'm still getting chills from the talk of Alton Thorne using nettles as his weapon of choice. And
you ever get stung by a nettle when you're younger, just on your leg?
Aye, that was enough. If I'm a wrestler and I'm going up, someone go, oh right, what's your weapon? Nettles. Yeah. Fuck off.
I've got this spot in mind, mate, but I've got this nettle and I just scrape it along here. It's like, no, all good.
Have you got fucking leaves?
I seen a death match, a clip of one, and a guy just had a sheet of paper and he just fucking gave him a paper cut right in between the fingers. Can't remember what death match it was, but he just held his hand up, paper cut right in between the fingers, and that made me squirm.
It's just littler things that, I mean, light tube, you think, oh, it's fine. It's spread across a further area of pain. Exactly. Like a little paper cut or a nettle sting or like a thorn or whatever. You're just like, no, that's concentrated. That's
so strange. So strange. You can throw it off the top through a table, most stupid spot, and then get stung by a nettle. No chance. No chance.
Oh, God, still gives me the chills. Anyway, we'll move on. So we've talked about kind of who you were looking at. When you started training, though, whether it's GPW or when you moved on, did you always kind of have your name in mind? Did you always have kind of what you wanted to do as Hunter Samson? Was that always, or did that develop the further you got to possibly debut?
No, I never actually had a name back then. I was almost just solely focused on training and trying to get a debut. I mean, I had a few names in mind that were just like, there's a cool name there, throw them together. But they would never stick. And even looking back on them, that would be an absolute horrible choice to even think that that would be a name that would work nowadays. But the Hunter Samson thing has only been since I've been at, well, for Andy at PWR Pro. I think I came up with it, and I touched on it in the other podcast, where it was obviously Hunter is the big nod to Triple H, and Samson is just, you know, mythical character of strength, really. So I just thought those two names worked.
Now you've teased us. Now, what was some of the worst? What was some of the worst names that you had in mind?
I honestly can't remember.
Blocked
they
out.
They were that bad. I've absolutely blocked them out. Like they will be in the back of the mind that I can remember. I think one of them was embarrassingly, it was Aiden something, Aiden Black or something like that. And it was, you know, I remember mentioning it to one of my coaches, and I was like, hey, Aiden Black, and he was like, well, Alistair Black's huge right now. It's like, you're not going to get away with that. It's just too similar. So I was like, all right, okay, there we go, buried with that one.
Aiden's not the most badass name either, is it?
Really, here he comes to the ring, menacing monster Aiden. You know, you're not gonna draw people in with that.
No,
that was Aiden. There you go.
Obviously, even more because one of my best mates is called Aiden, and now just rubbishing his name.
There you go. Horrible choice in hindsight.
Absolutely disgusting, especially if you spell it a way that it's Nadia backwards, and it just, you know, it opens you up for way more you need to.
Now you've told me that. It's, I made the right choice.
I know you could have had some pimple faced face shouting at you, going, ah, Nadia, and then everyone else would be shouting at you, and
Nadia backwards chant.
That would have been it. So GPWA, what decided to make you move on? Was it just because FPWA was closer, and when it opened up and Sandy's there, what was the decision for that?
Not at all. It was a completely different situation. I actually got injured quite stupidly, to be honest. I got injured maybe tail end of 2018. So just a training sequence. There's a spot where somebody drops down, do a cartwheel over them, like, you know, the famous sleep leap spot. Instead of like just jumping over them, he would do a cartwheel. I plant my right arm and I dislocate my elbow, like proper. I thought it was broken because I had a crunch, and people I spoke to from that session say they thought like my arm was split in half because the crunch was so loud. But I got injured, so it took me a while to heal because I think it was like a traumatic dislocation or something like that. My wrestling boots are actually still at Glasgow Royal. They phoned me a while after it, maybe a week or so after it, and they're like, oh, I think you left your boots here. I mean, you want them back? And I was just like, I don't think I'll be needing them anytime soon. I mean, I'm up to here in a cast, miserable. So I was just like, just spin them. They're just a cheap pair I got on Sports Direct, you know? So, yeah. So I got injured, actually. So it wasn't a choice. I got injured and I was out for months. Kind of. It's a bit miserable, a bit depressed, PTSD from being at training and stuff like that. If you go through a horrible injury, and I just kind of like, I was kind of dragging my tail with it, and then obviously COVID hit. So there was times where I was like, yeah, I'll get back into training and stuff. You know, obviously Andy opened up the school end of 2019, so I was like, yeah, this is where I'll go. This is my future. This is where I'll be. Obviously COVID hit, nothing was happening. That spread over like 2 years. I don't think most schools are doing anything but training seminars. I think it was like this, like a Zoom chat. We're sent wrestlers and coaches and stuff around the UK. And while that was going on, it wasn't actually contact training, and you weren't getting in the ring with anyone or properly physically doing the muscle memory reps. So just, you know, when everything opened back up, training, you know, I actually spoke to, on and off, Frank Gallo, who I've known for years, just from being from the same area. We're both Leaving and Methil Boys. We're actually PWR Pro holds the shows now at Truth and Leaving. That's where we grew up. We are legit the hometown heroes. But yeah, I spoke to him, and he was always like, yeah, you should be here. You should be here with us. You know, this is where you should be. If you want to come back, you're more than welcome. And then I think it was a month or so later, actually, I trained at the same gym as Andy Roberts. And I seen him there, and I was just like, do you know what? I'm just going to go and say hi. And because I'd known him from ICW and stuff, but I'd never really met him or been introduced properly. Introduced myself, told him I used to train. And he just was like, you know what? With open arms, you know, if you ever fancy dipping your toes back in, you're more than welcome. The door's always open. And within 2 or 3 weeks, I went back in, did the first row and bumps since 2018. Felt like death. Because that's the face it, we're not getting any younger. And yeah, since then, that was last summer. Since then, I've not looked back. Yeah, I've just kind of tried to run with it.
Well, I'm liking about, well, there's a couple of things I'll pick up on that story. One is the elbow thing. I can absolutely sympathize with, because, well, yours seems a bit more exciting, though. You broke yours, like, Bam Bam Bigelow was doing cartwheels, and our big guy. I broke my elbow by falling off a child's roundabout, and I was 21. So I know how that kind of, I can sympathize in that respect, because it does take a lot to get that strength back up. And was it your dominant arm as well, or was it? Yeah. Oh, it was even worse.
When I go over, I plant the right arm, so obviously it's a stronger side. So, it's stronger now. It was weaker back then, but you know, I've built it up, and it's a lot stronger now. But we've both got that in common, that we've both injured ourselves in an absolute ridiculous, stupid manner. And anyone that asks us about it, we're just kind of like, let's move on. I don't need to explain that. I injured it, that's it. You know, anytime I say it was on a cartwheel, everyone's like, why were you doing cartwheels? And I'm just like, it was a sequence, you know, we were all doing it. So, yeah.
It's one of those. We'll move on. The other thing was Andy Roberts seems to be collecting kind of, we'll say older trainees, but he seems to be doing great at finding or amassing like older trainees, like late 20s, early 30s as well. And he seems to just be firing them through very quickly, whether he's just tweaking what he needs to as well. And when I spoke to Andy, he was pretty much kind of the mindset of older people like yourself, older trainees that are coming in, they're that determined. They've got their life in order. They've kind of got, or should have their life in order, and have grown up, have matured. So they're just wanting to do what they need to do, train, get on a show, enjoy themselves. Whereas younger guys will come in and he didn't say this, but I got the vibe of dick about it a little bit because they're young and they could bounce and then they could take their time to get there.
100%, yeah.
Yeah, so again, that was just about, you kind of answered there, but was that it? Once you knew you were back in, you're like, right, I've only got a finite amount of time to do this, so I'm just going to play with it and do it.
It's like I said earlier, you know, we're not getting any younger. And the window, like realistically, the window for pro wrestling and the stuff you're doing, the bumps you're taking, you know, the window might be quite short for some people. If you're starting at like 17, 18 years old, you know, like you're saying, you maybe don't have that, like, right, the time is now, drive, maybe missing and dipping in and out of it and stuff. But I was speaking to Daisy Jenkins yesterday, because we were on the same show at Pro2, and then she's definitely of that mindset as well, where, like, you know, the time is now, you know, we need to do this, you know, anything we can get out of it, we can. And it's good to talk to people that are, like-minded, like yourself, because I think she's only maybe a couple of years younger than me. I think she'd done the exact same thing, you know, started a bit later, but just absolutely ran with it head first. And I mean, just look at the success that she's having now, just purely through hard work and stuff. And it is, you know, you see that. So, yeah.
Absolutely. I'm glad you mentioned Daisy, because I was about to, and then I think I realized every time I mentioned Daisy, I just kind of call her old, even though she's younger than me.
Sure. So... she would absolutely love that.
I know, that's it. I was like, don't mention Daisy. Oh, you mentioned her. That's fine. I can do it now.
A nice segue into your next question.
There we go. We'll talk about FPWA then. So before it was PWR Pro. Hoping to go for Power Pro. Haven't actually heard anyone say it out loud yet, except yourself when you went for PWR. That's where you made your...
I think it'll be referred to as Power Pro. I think people will just start saying that, and it kind of works. So
go for that. Made debut, according to my extensive notes here, November 2022, one of the student showcase shows. You ended up facing Tommy Kartel, which is very interesting and apt for what you'd be going on to do. Making that debut, though, was that did you feel like you kind of ticked off something off your bucket list? You were able to actually have a match in front of a crowd, or just how, what were your thoughts when you knew you were going to have that match?
It was good because I'd only been back training a couple of months. And obviously that muscle memory, you know, you've still got things that you've learned from before. Andy obviously saw that I was back ready again to work a match and stuff. So he trusted me with that. And the opportunity to work and be in a shooting showcase around about the Christmas time, when the, you know, family friendly and kids in there and stuff. I was just jumping at it, and it was a good feeling because it was almost like it's what I needed to kickstart it, because I wasn't maybe on the cusp of debuting before I got injured, maybe a few months out or something like that, from where I was advanced. But yeah, it was a good feeling to work in front of a crowd, you know, because it was in leaving and stuff. Friends and family were there. It was a proper full circle moment.
So I mean, if you've gone from being a fan and leaving to making your debut in the same place, it just
exactly. Like growing up, we never had that. We never had anything like that on our doorstep. So it was pretty surreal to be, because Truth Nightclub is like the nightclub in leaving. My old memories of being in Truth Nightclub, you know, I don't have much because you would black out. You'd be so drunk, you know, back in the day, you know, younger, going out and leaving, just being a stupid idiot when you're younger. So it was so strange for me to actually walk out there and be like, this is the club I used to just get absolutely steaming in. And now I'm wrestling in it. Madness.
You go in and it's, oh, this is what it looks like with lights on and sober eyes.
This is what it looks like when I'm ringing it.
So Tommy Kartel was your opponent on the night, and you ended up teaming with Tom, or being associated with Tommy Kartel a little bit as well. Is he someone that you bonded with through training, or was that just more of a, these are the two guys that have been put together? Who's your first match?
I think it was a combination of the both. I mean, at the time we got on with each other, you know, just, you know, in training, because he's also a bigger guy as well. Like we were saying about Razor Ramon, deceptively big, legit, maybe 6'2", 6'3". So he's not a small guy either. So most training sequences, most training drills, you know, try and get in with him, because it's someone of or as close to similar size as you. And yeah, from then just kind of got on. Yeah,
I wonder, I mean, you'll probably know better than I will, of course, because you're there, but I wonder if that was done on purpose so you would get a feel for the ring as well, because you're matched up with someone who could conceivably lift you or take you down or something, so you wouldn't be just the big guy who batters the little masked fella or something like that. Sorry, no,
Talon, love that guy. It was a good thing as well, a good matchup, because like you were saying, he's, you know, he can size up with me as well. So, and it's pointless, you know, getting thrown in with someone that you can just ragdoll or throw around, because you want to be able to actually just go in and actually have a competitive match with someone. So, and that's what it felt like.
I mean, you can do that in the future, but yeah, it was getting that first one where you feel accomplished and you're not just great Kali and or waiting or ordering the tassels for the future dancing gimmick. I'm pushing this on to you, unfortunately. I'll give it a couple of years. I'll be back.
As soon as I turn face, that's it. Luminous gear.
So from there, of course, we got Truth or Dare more recently, which had Tommy again and Daisy, you mentioned, becoming the hardest wrestler in Fife, officially. That's in the record books now. But how do you find your journey from that first match? Was that a confidence booster? Did it give you the confidence to go to other places like Pro2, Fair City, and advertise yourself as a wrestler? Or when did you actually feel that you became a wrestler? Was that in that moment?
I think so. I felt like I'd arrived on the scene in that moment. I felt like it was the start of something, a good launching pad. And obviously I was appearing on shows even before Truth or Dare for Pro2 and stuff like that. Even the, well, PWR Pro, the old FBWA shows at Truth, when we had the collaboration with New Wave, I was involved in the Fatal 5-Way there. I was ringside for it. I was even involved in the, you know, in the Summer Showcase Rumble match before the Iron Girders one. So I'd actually felt like I'd arrived on the scene more than anything. And it's all about just, you know, getting yourself known, getting yourself out there, just working as many places as you can. Because it's all well and good being online, social media and stuff like that, and saying, oh, you know, love to work here. But it's until that you are in someone's presence, or they can see you work in person, or something like that, that really sets you apart. So the more chance to work anywhere, the better.
Then again, it's down to that maturity as well. You're not even sitting there just typing, because you're not the most active on social media, because you're out there doing the work. That's as opposed to again, not shitting on younger guys again, which I seem to be trying to do in this episode. Is they'll spend time advertising themselves online, whereas you need to actually get yourself in front of eyes. Like,
oh yeah, there needs to be a combination of both. You need to do the work on online social media and stuff, because it's a, like it or not, it's a massive thing nowadays. It's a huge tool to use. It's helped me personally. But actually going out there and doing the work, it needs to be that 50-50 combination of going out there, actually doing the work, do your talking in the ring, and promoting yourself well, whether it be Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, whatever. Because if you have both, then it'll set you up and you're golden.
Yeah, I mean, for a lot, for me anyway, because I'm up in the Northeast, so my actual live wrestling experience is pretty much within a 50-60 mile radius, because I've got a 1-year-old and I don't really want to go away to shows overnight now. That's my cutoff point, it seems, as a grown up. So my experience of seeing yourself or seeing Tommy or seeing Daisy is online, and if you don't provide that content for me, you could have contacted me for an interview and I'd be like, I have no idea who you are.
Exactly. And that's the importance of it. Guys like yourself that would maybe not be able to get to a show, even other promoters around the UK, if they don't see what you're doing online, then why should they book you or promote you or want to work with you? Because if your Instagram is bare and you've got nothing to show for it, or no matches to show or any kind of content, then they're not going to want to promote you on the show or put you on it, because they just don't know. It's too much of a risk for them. That's the way I look at it anyway.
You're an investment to them. That's it. Because if you get booked, it's fantastic. Ace, you've agreed a fee, whatever. But then they put you on a graphic and then you do the show.
Yeah.
So you haven't advertised it. We don't know who you are. We don't know why you're coming. We don't know why we've got beef with this particular person. So when people when you arrive to the show, you're just like, oh, that's a big lad. Mm. Oh, he's made a scary face. So that's about the long short of it. So yeah, you're absolutely right.
And they'd be taking a gamble. So no point.
Yeah, and they'll be like, well, he didn't advertise the show. Let's not bring him back for another one. Yeah. But like I say, that's more down to maturity, I think, for yourself and the likes. We do have questions on Facebook and Twitter, so we'll get to them in a little bit. We'll just kind of round off the wrestling content before we get into some of this. Actually, they're all quite nice questions. There may be some odd ones that I'll throw in.
That surprised me.
You're probably aware of what the questions I'll ask will be, but we'll move on. So Pro2, you made quite an impact there at Pro2 Wrestling. Actually, you're one of the names that Logan Storm approached me with, going, get this guy on the podcast, get him on. And I had a look, see, it was like, oh, you've had a couple of matches, so I'll wait a little bit. And then, we end up having a chat anyway, a couple of months down the line. He was like, yeah, you've got to speak to this guy. He's great. That's a good plus point.
Always a positive.
If a promoter's directly going to me, going, we have to have this guy on.
No, I appreciate that.
So Pro2, you made quite an impact with them. You had a match with Logan Smith. They were just off a match, the Interpromotional Championship Gauntlet match, which he said first in, first out, unfortunately. Mm. But you know, easy night. Still get paid.
Just in, Billy. Come on.
Still get paid. Take the positive. You'll win the title one day.
There you go. Hopefully. Last two matches I've been in for Pro2, both title matches, and both came up short. So
TJ Rage next then.
There you go, heavyweight championship, right up, Mish.
Just work your way, work your way up. So coming into Pro2, it's a real kind of melting pot of promoters as well. Unfortunately, we don't cover some of the promotions that are promoted are on there, but it at least gives you a networking opportunity to pick up or pick up someone going, oh, well, do you need this guy? Do you need me for this show? And whatever. As well as that, I don't know, we'll talk Pro2 before I go to the other question I've got in my head. Yeah, how do you find your time in Pro2? You like say championship matches, plenty. Just another experience and our place to go. And like you said, Troon is a place close to your heart as well.
It is. And, you know, my whole extended family's from there. That's where, you know, Ayrshire in general is where most of my family's from. Mom grew up there. Gran, auntie, uncle and stuff. Even my cousins are from through there. My cousin was at the show first time yesterday to see me wrestle. My auntie and uncle as well, so that was good because it was just around the corner from them. But yeah, my time at Pro2 has been great. I've other than the two losses, I've no beef with it at all. Enough trust to be put in two title matches in my first two appearances for them. So that's got to say something. And hopefully I can continue to go there and make an impact and get a wee win streak going. You know, feed me someone. Feed me someone I can just throw around, take my anger out.
This is the times like I've done the fight in the big lads. No, give me a wee one. Give me a little one. Give me a Lucha DX.
Goldberg squash. There you go.
Give me something small throw. Excellent. My question. Oh, I've forgotten it. There's a question. Oh yeah. All right. So Pro2 in there, couple matches, big title matches for all of them. How important do you find to trying to get to shows nowadays as a trainee slash wrestler, just to get your face on there? Do you have a look to see what I'm free this weekend, or there's a show here? Do you try to get as many as you can now, just to at least show face and see what the scene is like?
Yeah, if there's a show on that really kind of piques my interest and stuff like that, I'll try and get along to it. I was at Discovery, and I think it was the July show, Disco Derby. I went along, watched that, met a bunch of the guys, sound as a pound. Good things to say about Disco as well. Hopefully that's a place as well that I can work soon. Really interested in working for Discovery. Looks like a great setup, production, talent. I mean, there's so much people in that roster that I reckon I'd have a great match with, or even a story. I mean, Caleb Valhalla's on that roster.
Yeah, that was my first thought.
You know, I mean, I don't know if you saw the footage from last Friday at the FCW Rumble, but we had a bit of a tussle, a bit of a brawl ringside.
I've seen some pictures. I haven't seen any of the footage yet. I'm still waiting to see Ardler Mania back again after going to the show. So I'm a little bit behind on my old FCW watching. But yeah, Caleb was my first thought when you mentioned that.
Still got the bruises on my body from where he sent me. You know, there needs to be a receipt down the line for that somewhere. So hopefully, whether it be FCW, whether it be Disco, we'd love to step in the ring with him for a proper one-on-one scrap. What a dynamic that would be.
Absolutely. I mean, he's a guy who's probably not, he's about the same height as me, but because he's so broad, he can lift you. That's a bit scarier. For folks that are laughing, yeah, Caleb's not usually that far from my mind. He's a very handsome boy.
Lovely beard. He's got a lovely beard. As a man that is appreciative of a bit of facial hair, lovely beard in the man.
But so have yourself. I mean, I've got such a fat face, like, and I try to do a shape, I just end up looking like Gimli from
Lord of the Rings. The last time I clean shaved was maybe 7 years ago. I'm just too scared now. I don't know what's underneath there. I don't know how far the chin goes in. Do you know what I mean? Like, this actually gives me a look of a bit of a jawline. But shave this off and no going back.
Oh, I'm the absolute same. I had to shave it all off. I had a wet shave for a wedding. I was the best man at. And my now wife can look at me for at least a week before I at least got some stubble back to it.
I'm fortunate that my partner likes a beard, so I'm happy in that.
Yeah,
I used to just have it there.
Yeah, beards are cool. That's just the little bit upkeep, sure. And if you do, I haven't done the Manscaped ad in ages, but here we go. 20% off SWN20 if you go to manscaped.com.
Now for the manscaping tips. Here comes questions. Here we go.
There we go. Right. Okay. What do you use on your beard? Do you have anything? Anyway, right. No, it's fine. We'll go to the Facebook questions. So we've got Patrick Petersky, of course, from FCW, First Aid Wrestling. I keep calling Peter Petersky when I do any sort of non-recorded thing. Anyway, how long before the tallest man in Fife officially becomes the hardest man in Fife?
Hopefully not long. Hopefully Andy can see that I'm wanting my hands on Tommy Kartel. One-on-one again, full circle, a year in the making. From last year, we've obviously had a little bit of a difference at the Truth or Dare show. You know, he whatever he wants to say, I had the match won. I had that sit-down choke bomb. The pin was there, and he broke up my pin. He was selfish enough to think that was his match, but I was also in that match wanting that win. So as much as he thinks that I've ruined it for him, he actually ruined it for me. And I don't know if you're aware, but after that match, he jumped me, sneaked at me, clubbed me in the back, and threw me against a brick wall. So I don't forget that. So hopefully Andy can see sense and give me what I want and give me Tommy Kartel at the end of the year, because that's what I'm wanting.
So, I mean, it sounds like from what you're saying there is technically, you are the hardest man in Fife if you were about to win the match. And then Daisy won, but she's the only reason, hardest man in Fife.
The only reason he's still calling himself the hardest man in Fife is because Daisy won it. You know, if it was anybody else, he would not have that monocle on him. No chance. And I will be taking that off him.
So, possibly come December when Christmas comes round. I think we've got another twas the night of the wrestling, I think, another one in December. So,
yeah,
fingers
that's
crossed.
That's coming up in December. So, hopefully, I can get my hands on him then. And if I'm honest, I don't really want a straight up match. I don't want a one-on-one contest. This has got to be no holds barred. For me, it's got to be no disqualification. He can't get away with it. He's not going to cheat his way to win. It's got to be street fight for me. And hopefully I can call in a few favours, and hopefully I can convince Andy to do this.
There we go. I don't know what street Truth Nightclub's on, but a miracle on whatever street fight. That sounds like
I'll happily take it to the street. I'll happily take it to other pubs. Throw them through the door of them.
There we go. So there's the challenge set out. If people are listening, Andy, get that booked. We do other questions. Pro2 have come in. Actually, that's a really good roundup question. I'll leave that one for a minute. We've got Dean Reed, who's asked, well, he's got two questions. First up is, Hunter, why did you get into Square Go and wreck my bathroom?
Right. Do you want me to answer that now?
If you want to answer it, yes.
Yeah. Oh my God. This was years and years ago. I'm maybe about 20, 21 year old. I've actually known Dean for years. We grew up together. But yeah, but house party, you know, a bit too much alcohol, a bit too much rowdiness going on. I ended up falling through his bathroom shower door and wrecking the whole thing. I think the toilet came off as well. I think when I fell through the shower door, my leg kicked out the toilet. So I've got some big boot in me, I tell you that. I take a toilet off its hinges. But, you know, that's I actually forgot about that.
And yet it was the cartwheel that broke you.
Exactly. I can fall through showers, I can break toilets, I can be thrown against brick walls and I'm borderline fine. But do a cartwheel, no chance. Broken man.
He did ask a serious question, which follows on from what we just discussed. He's put, after Tommy Kartel, after Tommy Kartel attacked you at the last Power Pros Wrestling Show, you go, and leaving, have you seen him? Have you reconciled? What would you say to him if he's listening?
I've not seen him. Don't want to see him, to be honest. I think I'm going to let my talking happen in that ring, or outside it. And if I've got a message for him, it's just be ready for what's coming.
I'm scared on his behalf, but you know, Tom Kartel is a confident man.
You shouldn't be scared, Billy. You shouldn't be scared, but he should definitely be scared.
Pro2 Wrestling, they've got a bunch of questions in. So we mentioned they were Logan was very, very. I was going to say pushy, but he was really nice about it. But wanting to get you on the show, so he's got a couple questions. What's the next step for Hunter?
The next step, maybe we just touched on it there. Hopefully, get my hands on Tommy Kartel in December. Hopefully,
TJ Rage. After that,
yeah, love to work TJ Rage for the title at Pro2. There's a lot of guys in the Pro2 roster actually that I would still love to work. Like you say, I've already worked Frank Cross, Logan Smith. I would love to work Krieger. I think Krieger's another big guy in that roster. You know, I interfered in the Frank Cross Krieger match in the August show at Pro2. I kind of inadvertently cost Krieger his chance at the Interpromotional Championship. So if he wants to run that, he can. If he wants to get a little bit of revenge on me, I'm happy to do that. But as far as what's next, tell Logan to line them up. Line them up and watch them fall.
And that's pretty much answered his second question, which is that's what we want to know. Which division does he have his eyes on, and who would be his biggest challenge? So the division, all of them. Who would be your biggest challenge?
Every single one. I would love to get my hands on the Ayrshire heavyweight title. I just watched the match that he had with Grado yesterday. A little bit of cheating, a little bit of conniving to get his hands still raised there. Don't think he would maybe get away with that with me. Grado's a different cat. But yeah, I would love a chance at that title. Yeah, so
fantastic. So we've got a little bit of time. Really, we're approaching the hour mark. I like to try and keep it that way, unless it all tailspins into, which it still may do. The afternoon is still young. We ask everyone the same questions. It doesn't matter if you're a big scary Hunter Samson or Scotty Hoy, you still get asked the same question. What's your favorite dinosaur?
My favorite dinosaur?
Yeah.
Oh God. Classic T-Rex. There you go. Yeah, it's gotta be.
That's absolutely fine. A respectable answer. The other question we ask everyone is, and this one causes quite a lot of divide on opinion, what would win a fight? Two sheep or one cow?
One cow. Being a bigger guy myself, but one cow. One cow boots them on the other side of the field.
Love it. So next time you're putting a handicap match, you'll be like, I'm the cow.
Exactly. I'm going to think of this moment, Billy. I'm going to be like, you know what? I said the cow can beat two sheep, and that's exactly how I'm going to play it. So
wonderful. Fantastic.
There you go.
So we've a couple weeks before this will go out, but what's kind of the rest of your looking at, other than hopefully Ragdoll and Tommy Kartel around leaving in December? Have you got anything else on the horizon that you want to try to, or where you want to try and get to in the next 12 months or so?
Like I'm saying, I mean, that's the only goal in mind I've really got to round the year off is get my hands on him and embarrass him in Truth Nightclub. But in terms of the next year, there's definitely promotions that I would love to work and go to. Start the year strong. I'd love to keep working for Pro 2. I think Discovery is a massive one. FCW, just continue on there, see what I can do there, maybe get my hands on a couple of titles there. Obviously, you know, the main goal is ICW. I would love to work there. There's that roster stacked with people that I'd love to work with. But yeah, just anywhere. There's a new Edinburgh promotion. Bleeding Gums, you mentioned them earlier. New deathmatch promotion. I don't think I would dip my toes in the old deathmatch wrestling to start off the bat. But to be on that promotion, I would love to be on that promotion. I'm aware that it's a new promotion, so you know the roster could be open for anyone.
Absolutely. And just before we go, someone else in FCW, you may have come across in the Battle Royal, the Fair City Rumble, would have been a guy called Hunter Redwood.
Yes.
Is there any possibility of I don't know if you saw Iron Girders, they had Deadpool Danger between Casino Brutale and Arcade Violence, possibly having to bring Deadpool Danger into this situation, because so there could only be one Hunter?
Well, I mean, I told him that when I seen him in the Rumble. I said there's only room for one good Hunter in this Rumble, and that's me, just before I clocked him in the jaw. So statement was made.
Hopefully next time he'll be cursed. Redwood or something like that, and just work his way down. But perfect. This has been an absolute blast. I'm glad to have you on, and
no worries.
We're able to have this chat. So, like I say, coming up, hopefully you've got Tommy Kartel. Once it's announced, we'll have it all over the website, as we always do. But before we go, we talked about social media. So, solely right, advertise social media. Where can people find out more about Hunter Samson?
I'm on Instagram as Hunter Samson Pro. I think it's Hunter Samson _Pro. On Instagram, I'm not on Twitter. I really probably should resolve that. I should probably make myself a Twitter, because then I could talk to the likes of yourself.
It's a horrible place.
Ah, well, there you go. But yeah, Hunter Samson Pro on Instagram. And that's it.
Excellent. Well, perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me today.
No problem, Billy. My pleasure as always.